So once war was a temporary state of affairs, a violent but brief interlude between times of peace. But today, America's wars are everywhere and forever. Its enemies change constantly and rarely wear uniforms, and virtually anything can become a weapon. As war expands, so does the role of the U.S. military. Today, military personnel don't just kill people and break stuff. Instead, they analyze computer code, train Afghan judges, build Ebola isolation wards, eavesdrop on electronic communications, develop soap operas, and patrol for pirates. You name it, the military does it. Well, today, this personal examination of the everyday proliferation of war and the shaky boundaries that maintain values of peace have created a war machine that is ill-prepared to handle legitimate threats to its nation. General David Petraeus, former commander of coalition forces in Iraq and Afghanistan and former director of the CIA, said of this book, "It's a hugely significant, very thought-provoking examination of how and why Americans' armed forces have been pulled into myriad missions beyond the strictly military task in which they traditionally engaged in past decades." Written by a woman uniquely qualified for such an undertaking. Kirk's reviews have said of Brooks that she never fails to stimulate and enlighten. Legal theorists and policymakers will approve the scholarship and close analysis, and general readers will appreciate the sensitive storytelling, the wit, and the uncommon good sense. Rosa Brooks, coming from an author family, we just hosted her brother, Ben Ironrack, a month or so ago for the Weight of the Spring, and we have her mother here, Barbara Ironrack, in the seat of honor. Anyway, Rosa Brooks is a senior fellow at the New America Foundation, a columnist for foreign policy, and a law professor at Georgetown University. She previously worked at the Pentagon as counselor to the Undersecretary of Defense for Policy in 2011, and she was awarded the Secretary of Defense Medal for Outstanding Public Service. Brooks has also served as a senior advisor at the U.S. Department of State, a consultant for Human Rights Watch, and a weekly opinion columnist for the LA Times. Her articles and essays have appeared in the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, and dozens of other newspapers and magazines. And she is a frequent television guest with appearances on The Charlie Rose Show, The Rachel Maddow Show, The Today Show, Meet the Press, and Aaron Burnett Out Front. So if you will, please join me in welcoming Rosa Brooks.
Thank you. Thank you, Davis, and thanks for having me here. A bookstore is actually the worst place for a book lover to talk about her own book, because even as I was standing back there listening to Davis introduce me, I was getting distracted by all these interesting-looking books and finding myself thinking, oh, I'll just take a look at this here. And I thought, wait, no, stop. But no, it's fantastic to be here. I've been here at many friends' book readings and book signings, and it's a real privilege. I see some people in the audience I know. I also see lots of people I don't know, which makes me really happy, because people I know and who know me have heard me go on and on and on about the themes in this book for many years, and they're probably really bored and tired of hearing it, but I hope that for those of you who don't know me, it'll be at least relatively new. So this is a book that, in some ways, I've been working on for a decade, more than a decade. I wrote an article. I'm a law professor, is my paying job. And I wrote an article in 2004 that was actually commissioned by a philanthropic organization. They said, we want to have a little workshop, and we want just to set it up so that people will argue with each other. We'd like to have one person write a short think piece arguing that the law of armed conflict is not adequate for the challenges posed by terrorism, and we're going to have somebody else write, yes, it is, and can we pay you a microscopically small amount of money to write the piece saying it's not adequate? And I said, sure, because I was broke and so forth. And I did a short think piece that led to a workshop that ultimately became a law review article that over more than a decade kind of worked its way into being this book. How everything became war and the military became everything. But I thought I would start by trying to give you a sense of the issues the book talks about by telling you a story. I have my mother here. I always bring my mother with me to events. Just in case I get upset and I need moral support. So my mother, Barbara Ehrenreich, is over here, sitting in this chair. And as some of you may know, my mother has written one or two books herself. And as some of you may also know, my mother is not known as a militaristic warmonger. On the contrary, she's somewhat known for other views. But when I was working at the Pentagon, at a certain point when I'd been there for a few months, I said, "Mom, why don't you come and have lunch with me? Come visit me at the Pentagon. I'll take you to lunch." And she said, "Okay." She hadn't really been. I don't think you'd ever been inside the Pentagon before. So Mom, she took the metro, and I met her at the metro entrance, and I got her through security, which of course is kind of difficult to start with. You've got to wait in lots of lines and present multiple forms of identification. And we came up the escalator, we went past the guards and so forth, and we went past the chocolate shop where you can buy little chocolate-shaped fighter planes, and we went past the florist, and we went past the CVS, and we went past the ATMs, we went past the Best Buy, which was there at the time, and we went past the food court. And suddenly Mom stopped. You know, she just stopped. I was trying to bring her on to the restaurant we were going to eat at, and she just stopped. And she looked around, and she said, "You're telling me that the heart of American military power is a shopping mall?" And yeah, pretty much. The Pentagon has about 23,000 people who work in it, a mixture of military and civilian employees. And over the years, it has sprouted restaurants and stores, eye doctors, and a DMV outpost, and a post office, and a barber, and an athletic shoe store. And it's sort of turned into, you know, one-stop shopping for the 23,000 people who work there, which makes perfect sense. And over time, the U.S. military, it's also turned into a similar kind of one-stop shopping for American policymakers. So at the Pentagon today, you can buy a pair of new running shoes, or you can order the U.S. Navy to patrol the Somali coast looking for pirates. You can buy some Tylenol at CVS, or you can send a team of Special Forces medics to Chad to fight malaria. You can buy a new cell phone, or you can, if you're important enough — I was not, I promise you — you can buy a new cell phone, or you can task the National Security Agency with eavesdropping on the cell phone communications of suspected terrorists. And you can buy a little tiny fighter jet molded out of chocolate. Or again, if you're important enough, you can order up a drone strike over Yemen. You name it, the Pentagon, the US military, now supplies it. And one of my, somebody I admire very much, retired Lieutenant General Dave Barno, once said to me, what's basically happened is the military has become like a super Walmart these days, with everything under one roof. And what we've seen is two successive presidential administrations, the Bush administration, the Obama administration, have been pretty eager consumers. This is not necessarily a cause for celebration. I think it's complicated. It's not necessarily a cause for despair. But the sort of relentless transformation of the military into the world's biggest one-stop shopping operation is both a product and a driver of some really seismic changes in how we think about war, with implications and challenges both for our laws and the rule of law itself, and for the military as an institution. And I think right now, and this is the overall theme of the book, is we're trapped in a kind of a vicious circle, where as we face novel security threats from novel quarters — cyber threats, bioengineered viruses, threats emanating from non-state terror networks that cross borders, threats that relate to the impact of poverty, political repression, genocide, refugee flows — what's happened as more and more threats seem to come from these very novel quarters, we have gotten into the habit of viewing all of these new kinds of threats through the lens of war. And as we view them through the lens of war, we ask the U.S. military to take on an ever-expanding range of tasks to try to deal with them. But as we view more and more things as war, it brings more and more spheres of human activity into the ambit of the law of war, a completely different legal framework than ordinary peacetime law, with much, much greater tolerance of secrecy, lack of accountability, coercion, and lethal force. Meanwhile, as we ask the military to take on more and more tasks, we need higher military budgets, which forces us to look for savings elsewhere. So we freeze or cut the budgets of civilian agencies such as USAID and the State Department, which hurts civilian diplomacy and development programs. As those budget cuts or freezes cripple the civilian agencies, their capabilities dwindle, which in turn leads us to ask the military to pick up the slack, which further expands its role. So we get into a situation, you know, everybody knows the old adage, if your only tool is a hammer, everything looks like a nail. If your only functioning government institution is the military, then everything starts looking like a war. And when everything starts looking like a war, then everything starts looking like a job for the military, and the cycle just goes around and around again. Why does this matter? Who cares? Well, for me, I'm a law professor, so with a background in human rights, so one of the things that I spend a lot of my time thinking about is, well, what are the implications of all this for rules, for norms, for values, for how we behave to one another, for democracy? And a lot is at stake. And remember the famous lines from Shakespeare's Henry V, in peace there's nothing so becomes a man as modest stillness and humility. But when the blast of war blows in our ears, then imitate the actions of the tiger, stiffen the sinews, summon up the blood, disguise fair nature with hard-favored rage. That's a really fancy way of putting something that's really quite simple, right? Which is that we have different expectations of how people should behave in wartime than in peacetime. In peacetime, if you walk out to the street over there and you take the biggest book you can find, a nice Art Deco by Norman Wolf here, which is extremely heavy, and you wait for the next person to walk by and you bash them over the head with this excellent book. Probably, we hope, what's going to happen is the police are going to come and you're going to be charged with assault and you're going to go off to jail, and if you kill them, you'll be charged with murder, because you don't get to walk around and kill people. And if you tell the police, well, I did it because he was my enemy, then the mental health professionals just get involved, right? But if you're a soldier in a conflict, if you're in a war, and you see your enemy coming along, and you bash them over the head with this book, or you shoot them, or you toss a grenade in their general direction, and you kill them, you're doing what you're supposed to do. You might even get a medal, right? So in its starkest form, right, if there's a war, if we frame something in terms of war, we expect violence, we expect coercion, we expect the government to keep secrets, they have to. We expect the government not to have, you know, a court deciding who gets to be killed and who isn't killed. We don't expect a degree of accountability that we would take for granted in time of peace. And for that reason, almost every human society, going back thousands and thousands of years, has worked really hard to draw sharp lines between war and not war, warriors and civilians. And just to give a few examples, the Navajo in the American Southwest, when warriors set out on raids, they would literally speak a different dialect with different verbs, different nouns. And when they came back from the raid, they would draw a line in the desert sand. They would face enemy territory, then they would turn around, face their home territory, walk over the line, and resume the normal language. Many other cultures have used war masks, war paint, war sorcery, elaborate rituals to distinguish the worlds of war from the worlds of not war. The Makeo Indians of Papua New Guinea believed that men who were going to embark on raids and war had to follow very strict diets and abstain from sex for a long period of time before wars, as they allowed the war sorcery to close their bodies to protect them from the enemy's weapons. When they returned, they had to similarly be abstinent, sexually abstinent, because if they forgot and had sexual relations with their wives, the war sorcery would leak into both of their bodies and poison them, the sense that war is literally toxic to ordinary human life. And we're actually not that different. Think about Western societies. Think about the elaborate rules relating to the law of armed conflict. Think about our expectation, really until quite recently, until the last few decades, that wars should be declared, which is a sort of archaic idea, right? I declare war. A speech act changes something from one thing to another. That wars would take place on geographically demarcated battlefields between the elaborately uniformed soldiers of hierarchically organized state militaries. Even today, we have elaborate rituals to separate soldiers from civilians. When we have new recruits, they go to boot camp, their hair is shorn, they become literally uniform, they learn a different dialect. We reward our soldiers with bits of colored ribbon that they wear upon their chests and bits of metal that has symbolic meaning within that culture but not necessarily outside of that culture. And we, just like so many human tribes before us, we name our weapons and our military vehicles after fearsome totem animals, and we can call them the predator, the reaper, the black hawk, the falcon, as if we too hope that in wartime our soldiers will take on the attributes of the predatory attributes that in peacetime we don't want, right? And despite all the changes that have been ushered in the post 9/11 era, most of us still view war as this distinct thing. We have this separate box called war. We have war and we have warriors. And we don't want war or the culture and values of the warrior to intrude into our everyday world of offices and soccer games and shopping malls. And we relegate war to the military, a distinct social institution that at the very same time we admire, we lionize, and we prefer to completely ignore. We like to think that war is an exception. Peace is the norm, war is the exception. But the trouble is that in today's world, with all these threats that don't fit neatly into a box called war and a box called peace, it's getting harder and harder to neatly say, oh, war is here, peace is here, they don't meet, wars begin, wars end. And you all know this, I'm not saying anything that people don't know in the post 9/11 era. When we've got cyber threats, when we've got transnational terror networks of loosely connected individuals, when we have financial threats, when we have bioengineered threats, all of our old categories that our law depends on start becoming almost useless. So think about this, right? In a cyber war, a war against terrorism, you can't have any boundaries in time or space. You can't say, well, you know, France is involved in the war and Switzerland is neutral. Those categories just don't make any sense anymore. We don't know where the battlefield is on a map. We don't know when a war on terror or cyber war could begin and end. We don't know what counts as a weapon. A truck driven into a crowd in Nice, a hijacked passenger plane, a line of computer code. We don't know what the enemy is anymore. Who is the enemy in the war on Al-Qaeda and its associated forces? It morphs and morphs and morphs until we're dropping bombs on somebody in Syria. Bodies are being broken, properties being destroyed, things are falling apart, but it's very hard to articulate exactly who the enemy is. And we've also lost any coherent basis for distinguishing between combatants and civilians. Somebody who doesn't wear a uniform, who is a terrorist planner, financier. How do we draw the line between someone who's a combatant and someone who's a civilian? It's always been a problem in conflicts, but now the exceptions are beginning to overwhelm the norms. The trouble is, of course, you know, going back to Henry V, when there's a war, the law of war applies. We lawyers call it lex specialis, fancy Latin way for saying special law, as opposed to the lex generalis, the general law. The law of war applies when there's a war. It doesn't apply when there's not a war. The law of war permits you to kill people who are your enemy without due process, without getting prosecuted later. Peacetime law, lex generalis, does not. So peacetime law emphasizes individual rights, accountability, and so forth. And when we can't tell the difference anymore, when we can't figure out what's a war and what's not a war, who, what's a weapon, what's not a weapon, where is the battlefield not taking place, not existing, who is a combatant, who is a civilian, when we can't figure out how to draw those distinctions in a principled way, we lose any coherent basis for making, frankly, the most vital decisions a democracy can possibly make. We lose any ability to make principled distinctions between what should be subject to judicial review and what doesn't need to be subject to it. What should be secret? What doesn't have to be secret? Who can be imprisoned? For how long? Why? Who can be surveilled and monitored? Who shouldn't be? When, where, and against whom can lethal force be used? Should we consider things like U.S. drone strikes in Yemen or Somalia, lawful wartime targeting of enemy combatants, or simple murders? You know, it makes all the difference which box we put things in. Makes all the difference between whether what we're doing is perfectly fine, nothing new here at all, no different from the invasion of Normandy. You shoot at oncoming German soldiers. You don't have to stop and ask a judge if it's okay. If it's in the war box, no problem. If it's not in the war box, whoa, murder. And we really want to know the difference, right? We really want to be on the right side of that line. And when we expand what we label war, it gets harder and harder to know, gets harder and harder to have any consensus domestically or internationally about what war is. It also has institutional implications for the military. It becomes harder and harder to make any kind of coherent decision about who should do what, when should something be a military task, when should be a civilian task. And today we have military personnel deployed in almost every country on Earth, and they do nearly every job on Earth. Some of them do exactly what we think of when we think of military, you know, we think of World War II movies. We have people who are out there in danger, crawling around in the dirt, shooting at people and getting shot at. We also have military personnel who are engaged in agricultural reform projects. They plan airstrikes. They plan micro-enterprise programs for Afghan women. They vaccinate cows. They train parliamentarians. They monitor global email communications. They try to develop programs to prevent human trafficking in the Pacific. You name it, they're doing it. This was kind of mind-blowing for me when I was at the Pentagon. I mean, one of the, you know, just realizing the incredible scope. And it was both really inspiring and kind of disturbing, you know, that you pick a topic, pick an issue, and there is someone, part of the Defense Department somewhere, who is working on it. They're doing research, they're trying to create a program, and it's quite amazing. A story that was told to me by another friend, former retired general, Major General Paul Eaton, telling me a story of being in Afghanistan, for instance, and realizing, to sort of somewhat oversimplify his story, that if we were going to have any kind of lasting stability in Afghanistan, that the agricultural sector needed to be reformed, and Afghans needed to have alternatives to growing opium poppies. And so he essentially calls up the Department of Agriculture here in Washington, and he says, "Hi, I'm an Army general. I'm here in Afghanistan. You know, we can kill a lot of Taliban, but we don't think this is going to work unless we can get some people here to help the Afghans diversify the agricultural sector. So could you please send some agriculture experts out here to help us and to help the Afghans?" And of course, the Department of Agriculture kind of goes, "You know, we have two people and they're really busy and they don't want to go to Afghanistan." And so the Army essentially says, "Uh-oh, here we are. We like the civilians to come help us. They don't seem to be able to." And so they look around through the military databases and they find a whole lot of Army reservists who are farmers or work for agricultural companies, and they call them up and they get them to Afghanistan, which, when you think about it, is both depressing and amazing, right? What other American institution has the ability to mobilize so much talent so quickly and move them to the other ends of the earth to do something, right? Nothing. We don't have anything else that can do that. Are these the right people? Not necessarily. Some of these poor guys are like, "I just, you know, I have a garden. I don't know if I can help the Afghans," you know, and some, but nevertheless, right? I remember when I was in law school, I briefly, in sort of delusional moment, thought I would go into a career in management consulting, and I had a job interview with McKinsey, big management consulting company, and they like to put you through all these interviews, elaborate interviews, where they pose hypothetical problems to you. And the interviewer said to me, "Okay, imagine that you run a tiny little family-owned general store and business is going great, but then one day Walmart announces that they're opening up a store a block away from you. What do you do?" And I sort of went, "Ho, well, it's all over. I roll over and die. I give up. Never mind. I'm going to go find another career." And that obviously was not the right answer. You know, I was supposed to say something like, "Well, you know, I'm going to start serving soy lattes and emphasizing my links to the community and the incredible artisanal things I can do and create a niche." But we all know that, in a sense, my first answer was probably the honest one, right? When Walmart shows up, all the little mom-and-pop stores do pretty much roll over and die. They get squeezed out. And like Walmart, today's military can marshal incredible resources and can exploit economies of scale in ways that are just impossible for little mom-and-pop shops. And like Walmart, the incredibly tempting one-stop shopping convenience that the military offers policymakers has a pretty devastating effect on smaller, more traditional enterprises. And in this context, of course, the mom-and-pop enterprises, unfortunately, are the U.S. Department of State, U.S. Agency for International Development, and so forth, other U.S. civilian foreign policy agencies, which are steadily shrinking into irrelevance in our ever more militarized world. The Pentagon isn't necessarily any better at promoting agricultural reform than USAID, and many would argue that it's usually a whole lot worse. But unlike civilian agencies, the military has the ability to get lots of people somewhere very unpleasant who are willing to work insane hours in terrible conditions, and it's open 24/7. So nobody likes Walmart, right? We all hate, yuck. We like bookstores like this. We don't like Walmart. And there are lots of good reasons for that. We don't like the cheap goods. We don't like its ubiquity. We don't like the oppression that we sort of suspect is at the heart of the enterprise. Most of the time, we don't want to see Walmart. We want to zone it off on some, you know, Route 1 somewhere and put it with all the other big box stores where we don't have to have it interfering with our sort of adorable little boutique-y downtown. But much as we resent Walmart, probably most of us every now and then we find ourselves going there, right? Because you need something. You don't want to go to five little stores. You know, you just want one-stop shopping, and so you go anyway. It's hard to live without it. And as the U.S. military struggles to define its own role and mission, it evokes similarly contradictory emotions in the civilian population. Civilian government officials want a military that costs less but can provide more, a military that will stay deferentially out of strategy discussions. Oh, we leave that to you, civilians. It's you're in charge of that. But will be eternally available to the ride to the rescue. We want a military that will take care of this ever-expanding list of tasks and our ever-expanding wars, but will never ask us to face any of the difficult moral or legal questions that are created by the blurring boundaries between war and peace. We want a military that can solve every global problem, but is content to stay away from the rest of us, safely quarantined on bases behind guard posts and barbed wire, separated from the civilian population by anachronistic rituals and acres of cultural misunderstanding. And indeed, even as the boundaries around war have blurred and the military's activities have expanded, nevertheless, at the very same time, the U.S. military as a human institution has grown ever more sharply delineated from the society it is charged with protecting, leaving fewer and fewer civilians with the knowledge and confidence to raise questions about how we define war, or about how the military operates, or about how big its budget should be, how we should structure it, and so forth. It's not inevitable that we have, that this is the way it is. It's not too late to change this. When I think about these categories we call war and peace and the very different sets of rules associated with each one, this category we call the military, this category we call civilians, you know, these are categories that we made up. Humans make up these categories. No divine power came down and said that calling something war, no matter what it is, no matter whether it looks like the invasion of Normandy or looks much more like law enforcement, no divine power said that just calling something war should mean that we don't need to have due process, or that certain tasks and only those tasks should be the province of people wearing uniforms or people not wearing uniforms. We came up with these concepts. We came up with these laws. We can change them. They're no more eternal than the kinds of lines in the sand that the Navajo drew. They're no more sacred than the kinds of rules any other human tribe has come up with. We need to think less about these formal categories and more about, you know, what kind of world we want to live in. What do we want to achieve? What's the point of these rules? Right now, we're in a universe in which, as we call more and more things war, we have less and less accountability over our own government's use of force. That's the way our legal system is currently structured. We don't have to keep it that way. We can change it if we want to. If that set of rules is not achieving what we want them to achieve, we can change them. We also don't have to accept a world in which the military has lost any coherent sense of what it's for. All of these things can be changed. If we don't like the moral and legal ambiguity, for instance, around drone strikes and targeted killings, If we worry about government secrecy and indefinite detention, we can mandate checks and balances that transcend that traditional distinction between war and peace. And I'm happy to talk about that if people have questions about that or comments about that. If we don't like the way we simultaneously isolate and lionize and Walmartize our military, we can change that too. We can change the way we recruit. We can change the way we train our military. We can choose to see what has happened as the militarization of U.S. foreign policy. We could also see it as the civilianization of the U.S. military and the chance to invent different kinds of institutions which can call on and mobilize enormous human talent and use it in many different ways. It's most military leaders don't particularly want to be presiding over Walmart. I think a lot of military leaders are fearful that in the end, not only does the expansion of war and the expansion of the military's role cause legal and moral conundrums, but that in the end it can be dangerous for the military itself, that the military, under constant pressure to be all things to all people, might eventually end up being able to offer little of enduring value to anybody. And I think of it as, you know, Walmart on the after the Black Friday sale, right? Where it's stripped almost bare by a greedy society that wants what it has, and all you're left with is demoralized employees and some shoddy mass-produced stuff kind of strewn about in the aisles, and nobody wants the military to end up like that. I think that these are issues. It's interesting. When I talk about these issues to military audiences, I actually often get much more head nods than when I talk about these issues with civilian audiences, which is kind of fascinating to me. I think that these are a cluster of issues that are obviously fairly urgent if you're in there being told, hey, you know, go fight terrorism and fix Iraq's economy and, you know, and fight malaria. But oh, by the way, we're not gonna train you to do it that way, and everybody's gonna be mad at you when you screw it up. Obviously resonates substantially with a lot of people. Well, I'm going to stop talking. I would love to get your reaction. I find it in some ways hard to talk about the book because anything you spend so long working on, you want to simultaneously read every page out loud to everybody and say to everybody, oh, that's really boring. Let's talk about something else. Now let's talk about this book, which looks really good too. But thank you for being so patient and listening. And I would love to get your questions and your comments. Okay, and we have these two microphones, and I'm told that everybody's supposed to line up in a neat, orderly fashion behind them. And I have absolutely no idea which microphone I should go to first, but you're wearing pink, which means I can see you. If you wouldn't mind just introducing yourself briefly, that would be great for me.
Hi, my name's Janine Hall, and I have a question about emergency war powers. And I understand that the document that President Bush signed in on 9/11/2001 put us in a temporary state of emergency power. I'm not sure if it's a war power or what it is. I'd like to know more about what it is. And I understand, I've heard, but I can't find any information on whether I have heard that it has been renewed every year since then. And I'd like for you to talk a little bit about how that relates to your thesis.
Yeah, okay. So I think what you're talking about is what the authorization to use military force, AUMF?
No, it's a suspension of some constitutional powers. It's not the authorization.
Okay.
To go
so
to war.
I don't think there's no one thing like that. What we do have, through the Patriot Act, through a variety of other legislation, some of which predates 9/11, that there are emergency provisions. There are emergency provisions in economic law, for instance, that allow certain kinds of sanctions. There are emergency provisions in some of the laws that relate to surveillance and so forth.
And
there's no
corpus?
There's no one proclamation that occurred. What there were was the activation of some of the emergency powers in a really wide range of legislation combined with the authorization to use military force, the effect of which combined has been in many ways to dramatically give much more latitude to the federal government in a wide range of ways, looking whether it's looking at surveillance, whether it's looking at the ability to place restrictions on certain kinds of activities, whether it's looking at the ability to use force against a widening range of groups. Mm-hmm. So I think you're absolutely right that one of the things that we've seen in the post 9/11 world has been a series of emergencies that end up getting extended and extended. We're actually seeing the same thing in France right now. We're seeing a state of emergency. In France, it was a formal state of emergency that just keeps on getting extended, which obviously in both the U.S. and in France eventually raises the question of, you know, when is an emergency just the new normal? And I think in all kinds of ways in the U.S., emergency powers, both through domestic law and through expanding what we call war and then apply the law of war to, We've reached that state where the emergency has become the norm in a lot of ways that are very damaging. But I, in some ways, it would be easier, right, if it was one piece of paper. I think part of the reason it's been hard to see is precisely because it was across so many different domains.
Thanks. So. Thank you.
Sir?
Well, I'm going to take you up on what I think was your invitation to ask very general questions about sort of the balance of civilian and military spheres. In your description of this sort of increasing diversification, Walmartization of the military, and the fact that ordinary citizens are less and less capable of really understanding what's going on and so forth because of the complexity of things, you were still careful to say, it seemed to me you were saying that we still have control. We have that the political system still has control of the military, and that the U.S. Constitution will, mm-hmm. you know, kind of is the basis of that. But I'm just wondering if you have any real fears along these lines. Is it conceivable in your mind that in the foreseeable future that either a political leader would be able to compromise that, or that somebody within the military would begin to orient the military more towards a political force mm-hmm. in the United States than it currently is. So that's admittedly
Here's the good news. Good news first, I think there is absolutely zero likelihood of a military coup in this country. I think that the U.S. military has really internalized the norms of civilian control. And believes in it very, very, very strongly. Here's the bad news. There are ways in which it matters less and less because precisely as we lose any clarity, not because of any kind of conspiracy, just because the world is getting more complicated, right? Mm-hmm. As we lose any clarity over what is a military task and a military decision, the whole idea of civilian control gets kind of undermined in a variety of ways. And here's the, Ironically, there are times when the military's internalization of the professional norm of, hey, we stay out of strategy, the civilians do that, we just do military stuff, actually becomes a problem, right? Because since nobody knows anymore what's civilian stuff and what's military stuff, sometimes that means that the military is keeping quiet when political leaders really need their input into things. Right. I think that there is a kind of quiet seepage which goes in both directions, mm-hmm. Actually, let me mention something that maybe is implicit in your question. Mm-hmm. A few months back, Donald Trump was giving speeches saying, I would bring back waterboarding. I would do a hell of a lot worse than that. If that's what we need to get terrorists, I'll bring it back. And if we can't get rid of terrorism the way we're doing it right now, you terrorists, you got to take out their families. You got to take out their children. That's the only thing that'll show them what's what. And there was an immediate outpouring of objections, including from many very senior military and retired military officials saying, whoa, those are war crimes. We don't do that stuff. And so Trump was asked, you know, are you, what would you do? Is the military going to obey you? They're not going to commit war crimes. And he said, I'm a leader. They'll do what I tell them to do. And everybody said, oh, whew, that's right. I actually think it's more complicated than that. I'm a little bit more worried because I think no president, not even a Donald Trump, the way bad stuff happens is not that a president says to the military, I order you to commit war crimes. I order you to murder innocent civilians. That right. happened. Everybody in the military stands up and says, no, are you kidding? We're not going to do that. But that's not the way these things happen. The sort of quieter, more subtle way these things happen right. is that, you know, you get a bunch of lawyers and they say the children of terrorists are actually materially supporting terrorists. They're actually terrorists themselves. And so they're lawful targets and waterboarding is not torture. And by the time it reaches the military personnel, it's gone through 16 layers of lawyers who've signed off on it, and they're not told to commit a war crime. They're told, don't worry, everything is fine, it's lawful. And, well, boy, if you're a military, you know, if you're an officer or an enlisted person, it's really hard to say no. And, in fact, you'd fear that you yourself are going to be prosecuted. So I think there are some insidious dangers that neither the Constitution right. nor our norms of civilian control will protect us against.
Right, thanks.
You mentioned indefinite detention, and you also said we can change things. So I wonder if you have any suggestions for how to deal with the people who are still detained in Guantanamo after all these years and cannot be charged and apparently cannot be tried or released.
Mm-hmm. I actually think that although Congress has certainly made it harder for Guantanamo to be closed, President Obama, I think, has the constitutional power to close it tomorrow if he's willing to take the political risks. You know, the Congress does not have a constitutional mandate to interfere with his decision. You know, there's nothing in the Constitution that says Congress gets to decide who gets detained as a prisoner in an armed conflict forever. The U.S. has had prisoner swaps in every war in our history. You know, to me, this is actually not that hard of a problem. It's a very small number of people. Their dangerousness at this point is pretty minimal, particularly because if these people were released into any country in the world, they would be the most carefully surveilled and monitored people in history by multiple intelligence agencies. You know, I think that is there a risk that if you set everybody in Guantanamo free tomorrow and you said, goodbye, good luck, see ya, is there a risk that some of them would turn around and try to get involved in terrorist plots against the United States? Sure, absolutely. To me, that risk is a good deal lower than the risk of the damage to the United States and to the rule of law internationally to maintain a precedent of indefinite detention based on hypothetical future dangerousness in a conflict, you know, in a war that has no likely ending. So to me, it's the problem is lack of political will. There's no legal barrier to closing Guantanamo tomorrow. A leader who's willing to accept a certain amount of risk, you know, it's the old Dukakis problem. Nobody wants to be that guy who, you know, somebody comes back and does something awful. But to me, it's really fundamentally not any different from the standard criminal law rules against using tainted evidence. Does the prohibition on using evidence that was illegally seized by the police mean that some guilty people will go free and do bad things? Yes, it absolutely does. But we as a society have said better to bear that risk than to have something that creates an incentive for police to play fast and loose with constitutional rules. I think it's fundamentally the same issue. So I don't think there's any legal barrier. I think it's just a unwillingness to take the political risk.
Thank you. I'm going to tell Obama that you said that.
Feel free.
Hi. I have worked on the economic side for USAID in several countries and wanted to comment a bit more on what you were talking about the huge gulf in resources, because I think a lot of it boils down to purely money. Congress is always willing to give lots of money to the military, sometimes more than they ask for, whereas civilian agencies get cut back. And I can recall, first came to me in Serbia, we weren't at war at that point. They weren't even at war. And I ran into a military guy. Oh, yes, I'm in charge of our sort of development stuff. Three times the budget that we had, and not any indication of what they were doing. Now, we fought hard in Afghanistan. My tenure there, as everyone's, was limited. But the Army's inclination is to just give things away because, hey, they've got lots of money. And we said, well, people won't be able to sustain a business if they can't mobilize the resources mm-hmm. to pay off loans. So these are a lot of issues, combined with the fact that the military, certainly in war areas, has much more mobility.
Yeah.
So I'd like you to, it's hard to see how one could pull any of this back. Plus, I wonder, I don't think that the military leaders necessarily want to do all this, but what about the ambitions of the civilian leaders? And of course, my ogre in chief is Donald Rumsfeld, who certainly seemed to want everything.
Yeah, so when President Obama first came into office, he made a number of speeches talking about rebalancing and redirecting resources and authorities back to civilian agencies. And then Defense Secretary Robert Gates and then Secretary of State Hillary Clinton did sort of a tour together, making speeches saying we need to reinvigorate the civilian sector. And Secretary Gates said, you know, the military can't do its job if we don't have strong, capable civilian agencies able to do their jobs. And nothing happened. So here's where I sometimes part company from some of my friends. It is sort of a truism in Washington. We all run around saying, oh, we need to reinvigorate the civilian sector. And I sometimes ask people, how likely do you think it is that this is going to happen in our political lifetimes, that Congress is going to say, oh, what a terrible mistake. Let's quadruple the budgets of the civilian in the foreign affairs budget and so forth. And they all say, well, not at all likely, it's not going to happen. And it seems to me that at a certain point, if it's not going to happen, if it's just not going to happen, let's stop running around saying, oh, that really ought to happen, you know, because it won't. And let's figure out what's the next best option. And it seems to me, as I said before, you know, you can see what's happened as the civilian, as the militarization of U.S. foreign policy, or you could see it as the civilianization of the military. It seems to me that if the reality is that the nature of American politics is that we're going to continue to throw money at the military and ask the military to take on all these tasks, then let's make sure the military can do them well. And that has enormous implications for everything from how we recruit, how we train, who we recruit, the personnel system, the acquisition system, the acquisition programs and rules. And I got myself in some hot water a few years ago by writing a sort of tongue-in-cheek column for Foreign Policy in which I said, you know, if we want our military to be doing economic development programs and governance and micro-enterprise and so forth, we ought to start recruiting at the AARP conferences. And everybody said, well, that's crazy. That you can't say that. And I was only partly joking, right, that we still recruit and train for a kind of a 19th century military. You know, we primarily recruit, you know, 18 to 22-year-old boys. And there is nothing wrong with 18 to 22-year-old boys. There are many wonderful 18 to 22-year-old boys. But if what you want, in part, your military to do is micro-enterprise programs for Afghan women, it's not obvious that that's your target demographic to recruit, right? But it's really hard to change these things. You know, that you might want to have a military with radically different rules for how you promote, how you retain people, much more ability for people to go in and out of the civilian sector and come back in without sacrificing any forward mobility in their own careers. So I actually think that there are the other way to fix the problem is to say if the military is going to do it, let's think about how we would need to transform the military itself. This, as I said, it's this kind of amazing institution, right? Lots of incredibly idealistic, really talented people who will go anywhere, you know, and not say, oh, I don't feel like going to Iraq, you know, that they'll just go and they'll do it. Let's take that amazing institution and help figure out how to make it better, how to bring in the expertise that's not there right now.
So is that the message of your book?
One of the many messages.
A lot of what you're talking about has intensified since 9/11. The military budget under the Bush administration essentially doubled. We spend over $80 billion a year on intelligence agencies. And when Obama came in, a lot of us thought, wow, he's going to dial this back. We were very, very optimistic. And I certainly think he had that in mind, but he's made very little progress. The budget's gone down ever so slightly. Now, Andy Bacevich, who spoke here...
Ticking up again now.
Yeah, exactly. Andy Bacevich, who spoke here last year, argues that the national security state has a life of its own. Presidents come and go and have very little ability to change national security policy, either policies or spending. Now, when you say, we can change it, you know, in theory, you're right, but looking down the road, I don't see any president on the immediate horizon who's going to do that. So it's very difficult. I mean, if Obama couldn't do it, is Hillary going to do it? And looking down, you know, or are we just stuck with it?
No, I think there's lots of truth to that. You know, that bureaucracies get spun up. People's jobs are connected to these categories and programs we've created. It gets really, really hard to dial them down. I suspect it would have taken a presidential lobbying initiative on the scale of getting health care reform for President Obama to seriously change any of this. And, you know, to be fair to him, health care reform was kind of important, too. I think he probably figured he couldn't do both, and he was going to focus on that, you know. So I don't think it's impossible, but I think you're absolutely right. It would have to be a top presidential priority. I can't see Hillary Clinton making that her top presidential priority either. That said, I'm not totally pessimistic, in part because I think that these conversations are beginning to happen both within the military itself and on the Hill more and more, as partly because, you know, to put it bluntly, our adversaries, the Russians, Chinese, our frenemies, right? They're pretty good at playing in that realm sort of between traditional war and traditional peace. Our military is struggling mightily to say, whoa, you know, if we're operating for the foreseeable future in much of the time, at least in this kind of murky terrain that doesn't look exactly like traditional war, but doesn't look exactly like peace either, what does it mean to get good at it? What kinds of rules do we need? What kinds of norms do we need? So I think those conversations are happening sort of organically already. Does that translate into something magic? No, I don't think so. But do I think that over time we may get a little bit better at some of these things? I think it's possible. I also think that, and I may be being overly optimistic about what a President Hillary Clinton would do. I actually think that she, in some ways, more than President Obama, has been attuned to the rule of law problems associated with things like U.S. targeted killings. So I actually, in some ways, am a little baffled, quite frankly, by why the Obama administration has not done more to increase accountability and transparency on things like that, because I don't think it's that hard. I think I think there are hard problems, lots of hard problems, you know, restoring the civilian sector, that's a hard problem. But increasing things like accountability for drone strikes, that actually strikes me as a relatively easy problem. Not for 100%, but sort of to get to 85% strikes me as pretty easy. And not requiring a huge amount of political will or capital. And my sense is that Clinton, based on the kinds of issues she brought up when she was Secretary of State and the kinds of issues that she's bringing up with her campaign staff, might actually be, on that issue at least, more willing to take some actions to get us to a better place than President Obama has been.
Thank you.
Well, my question may be a little oblique to the main directions, and if so, you can just move on to the next question. But I remember when the Iraq War started, a big issue was that percentage of military and people working nominally for the military were really civilian contractors, and that this had blown out of proportion. And how much of a factor this may play, and when one tries to organize or imagine bringing things under control.
Yeah, I mean, it's a natural development in a sense, that precisely as we start saying to the military, oh, guess what? Not only do we want you to shoot at those bad guys, we also want you to, you know, fix Iraq's economy and fix their judicial system, that the military sort of says, well, you know what? We don't quite know how to do that, plus we don't necessarily have the linguistic skills and so on. Let's outsource it. We can probably hire somebody who does. So part of the push towards contractors is precisely to bring in people who at least hypothetically have skills that aren't necessarily resident in the military, and partly it's a sort of effort to say, well, we don't know how long we're going to need to do this. It doesn't necessarily make sense to try to teach everybody to speak Arabic because we don't know where we're going to be next, but we can outsource. We can find people who speak Arabic, bring them in for these tasks, and so forth. I do think that's the kind of charitable explanation, and it's not such a bad thing, right? I do think that there has also been some slightly nefarious stuff going on, that sort of outsourcing many tasks to contractors also provides a way to, in some ways, make more murky the costs of war. We keep careful tabs on the number of U.S. military personnel who are killed and wounded. We do not have an equivalent careful accounting of the number of contractors killed and wounded. There are ways in which the expenditures on contractors are hidden across multiple budgets, which makes it also harder to figure out exactly how much money is being spent. And it makes the scope of U.S. military involvement a little harder to see. So I think that there are some not so good reasons as well as some not so good consequences of the reliance on contractors. So I don't think it's an inherently a bad thing, right, to use contractors, provided we have transparency and accountability about what it is we're doing, and provided that we have some coherent basis for saying, here's what we think should be done by contractors, here's what shouldn't be. One thing that the legal thing that does worry me, we saw this, for instance, in the raid that killed Osama bin Laden, where we had a mixture of intelligence agency personnel, military personnel, and civilian contractors working together. Again, not necessarily a bad thing, do what works, but from a legal perspective, it further muddies the water on, well, who's a combatant, who's a civilian, who is targetable? If you're a combatant, if you're a member of the U.S. military and you kill Osama bin Laden and he's a combatant, which he clearly was, that's an easy case, right? There are lots of hard cases. That one's a pretty easy one. You have, under the law of armed conflict, you have combatant immunity. You're allowed to go kill people. You're allowed to kill the enemy. If you're a civilian, you don't necessarily have that. So I think that we're creating a situation in which we both potentially risk rendering some of our own civilians and contractors targetable under the law of armed conflict by others. We potentially render them liable for violations of the law of armed conflict and criminal law by kind of muddying the waters. And it makes it really hard for us to say to other people, whether it's Vladimir Putin or whether it's, whatever latest iteration of a terrorist group, to say, we're going to treat you differently because you don't wear uniforms and yet you're engaging in what we think of as armed conflict, when obviously we are increasingly doing the same thing ourselves. The legal status of a civilian contractor assisting with a drone strike is pretty murky and sets some potentially pretty dangerous precedents.
So we're getting really close to the end here. We've got four people remaining. So if we will ask your question really quickly, and we'll go through all of them and then see if you could comment on just the last four questions real quick. So if you will, thank you.
My question sort of turns everything upside down, or maybe it. I'm fascinated by the mother-daughter relationship, and
I'm not going to comment on that. I'm going to let her comment on that.
But certainly, it's been the dream of people opposed to war for a long, long time that there would be a world police, and certainly many U.S. political leaders will say, we are not the world's policemen. But what you're describing is that we are evolving towards a world where the United States are the policemen of the world, with all those problems. But that would be perhaps a positive way to talk about all this. We certainly want Judge Correll, when he was going after the Sinaloa cartel, we wanted him to be protected by the U.S. military, and he was. Certainly in South Sudan right now, human rights workers are getting raped and killed. We would like them protected by some group, and if the U.N. can't do it, maybe the military, U.S. military could. So are we becoming the world's policemen?
Okay. We'll take the next one behind it.
Thank you. Slightly different. You've drawn very, very graphic picture about the tension between the military and the non-military. What about the distinction between the military and intelligence? Here we have two special laws,
as opposed to general law, and an evolution where those lines become blurrier and blurrier, at least as viewed from a distance.
Okay. Over here.
Hi, my name is Ian Philbrick. I'm an 18 to 22 year old male, so thanks for the shout out. I'm also a student at Georgetown, so thank you for teaching there.
And all the 18 to 22 year old males at Georgetown are excellent.
Oh, thank you for saying that too. I listened to you. You spoke about how the sort of Walmartization of the military works internationally when the battlefield is blurred, but it's mostly outside the U.S. I'm curious about how that affects the home front as well, or the homeland. I listened to your podcast with your colleagues at Foreign Policy talking about your book, and you mentioned wanting to go a little bit more deeply into the militarization of the police or how that affects sort of the other side of the civilian-military divide. And I'm curious about that in two ways. I guess one, whether it's intensified after 9/11 in a way that's directly sort of tied to the growth of the military in a budgetary sense or in terms of selling vehicles that were deployed in Iraq to police departments. And then I'm also curious if there's sort of a cultural effect that you would point to that isn't directly tied maybe budgetarily or isn't linkable in sort of ways that would appear on a ledger, but that you can still tie to this sort of overreach of the military or growth of the military.
It's a little tall. So my question might actually turn out to be a good conclusion, as it turns out. Like you said, we've got personnel across the globe. We have special forces in Yemen, Somalia again. We have contractors all over, in a sense, in the way that John McCain said, our own Defense Department doesn't even know who we're employing. So my question is, and with those special forces, we sometimes don't know they're there until the newspapers report they're there. We hear from the Defense Department that they're not on the front lines. They're in a training capacity. Then we hear from the newspapers that they're dying on the front lines. So my question is this it? Has war become obsolete in this age?
I think we have one more person who's been waiting. Davis, can we add one more? Sorry.
Good evening, Professor. My name is Kevin Benson. I'm from a school teacher from Kansas.
Hi, Kevin.
Hi. Is part of the answer getting my students back involved in strategy? Thank you.
All right. Kevin didn't mention that he's a school teacher at a little tiny school called the School of Advanced Military Studies, which trains some of the brightest Army officers for leadership positions. Let me start with your question first, Kevin, and actually this connects to yours about special forces. You don't always know they're there. My husband back there is also hiding. He's a just retired special forces officer. He's hiding behind that bunch of books. And if Kevin and Joe back there were involved in strategy, the whole world would be a better place. I actually think that the military has to be involved in strategy discussions, that the artificial line that we've created that says, the sort of classic Samuel Huntington separation between civilians and military that says, the civilian set the strategy, the military executes, and that's the end of the story. It just doesn't make any sense anymore when the sort of sharp line, it was always kind of a fiction, but now it's just a kind of untenable fiction that as we involve the military in more and more activities, how do you not involve them in discussions of strategy? How does it make any sense not to? And I think we saw this an example where this came up really clearly is the 2009 debate about troop levels in Afghanistan, which kind of brought some of these contradictions out, where President Obama comes into office, he creates a special little commission to go out and reevaluate U.S. strategy in Afghanistan. That group comes back and says, well, we need to have this strategy that combines sort of counterinsurgency with counterterrorism, and we need to improve Afghan governance and legitimacy of governance and so on and so forth. And so then they say to General Stanley McChrystal, who had been appointed to run the U.S. efforts in Afghanistan, you do a study and come back to the White House and say what resources are needed to fully implement this new strategy. And so McChrystal comes back and he says, essentially, well, we need a whole lot more money, we need a whole lot more troops if you want us to implement that strategy. And the White House goes, that's too much. No, you can't have that many troops. Come back and give us a different number. That number is too high, causing a bit of a crisis. And everybody got mad at each other. And what McChrystal probably should have done is come back and said, You asked me a question. You said, what do we need to do to implement the strategy? I gave you my best answer. If you don't like that answer, ask me a different question. But he didn't say that, because what he was really saying, and what he didn't want to say, and maybe should have said, and maybe it would have been better for the White House if he had said, was, you know, you want to pursue a strategy that doesn't really make sense, because that's a strategy that would require so many resources, it's probably not worth it. You know, but because of really strong norms that say, no, generals don't come back and say, I'm not sure your strategy makes any sense, it's too expensive, he instead kind of goes, well, but I can't, you know, that's just how many troops it takes, and everybody has a fight, and the White House says, you're trying to box us in, and why do you military people always want more troops? And the military says, why is the White House asking us crazy questions and not changing their question? You know, what are we supposed to do if you say, what does it take to implement the strategy? I'm giving you the answer, for God's sake. You know, and partly it was a kind of different views of what the role of the military was that led to a lot of cultural misunderstandings. So I think we have to have the military voicing opinions about strategy and feeling empowered to say, I don't know if that strategy makes sense. That doesn't mean that the final decision isn't made, obviously, by the elected political leaders, but I think that kind of artificial distinction between military issues and non-military just doesn't make that much sense. Your question about special forces and special operations troops being deployed and potentially engaged in combat in places that Americans don't always know about, I want to actually connect that to the earlier question about the military community versus the intelligence community. I do think one thing that troubles me a lot is that as we've seen more and more involvement of the military in unacknowledged activities and more merging of sort of intelligence roles and military roles, we've seen the CIA take on more and more of a paramilitary role. We've seen the military get involved more and more in intelligence gathering. Again, I think these are natural responses to a world in which threats are not packaged neatly anymore. But one thing I do worry about quite a lot is that we are seeing kind of more and more U.S. foreign policy and national security policy kind of disappear into the covert, unacknowledged world, in which it's very, how do you have those crucial conversations about how much money should we spend? What should we be doing? Is this morally, legally, ethically right? Is it working? Even leaving aside all those questions, becomes impossible to have those conversations in a smart and intelligent and useful way when anytime you try to say, raise a question, somebody in the government says, if you knew what I knew, you would be fine with this, but I can't tell you, I'm sorry. Yeah. Boy, wait a minute. You can't go anywhere with that. You can't go anywhere with that at all. And I do think that pushing back on sort of disappearing so many things into the covert world is something that's just vitally important. I worry about in terms of the effect on legal precedents too. What does it do to legal precedents when states are doing things based on secret legal arguments that they don't reveal and that they never acknowledge what they're doing? It's not good. Let's see. Is the U.S. becoming the global police? To some extent, and one of the things that I talk about in the book is, and didn't talk about here, but I hope, of course, you're all going to go buy the book, right? So then you can read it, because it's much better in the book. You have to buy it, though. One of the things I talk about in the book is the ways in which, as the salience of borders gets reduced, the kinds of global institutions, both the legal framework and the political institutions we have internationally, are less and less effective. I do think that we are at one of those moments historically not that different to the moment before World War II, when we have an international architecture that is just kind of incredibly unstable, and we're all pretending it's fine and it's going to keep working. We know what happened, obviously, you know, World War II, it all fell apart. And after World War II, we created a whole new global architecture, legal architecture and political architecture, the UN, the UN charter system, the collective security arrangements that go with that. I think that system itself is now under tremendous strain, that as we face more and more problems that cross borders, sovereignty makes less and less sense, and yet we don't have any alternative. And so what we're seeing as a result is states such as the United States resorting to unilateral action, again, not because we just don't care about the law, but because we're responding to real things out there in the world. But as we do that, it undermines even more that sort of unstable global architecture. It would be useful to have world police, but having one state take on that role without a system of rules that other people around the world have bought into is pretty dangerous. Whether we will succeed in kind of feeling our way to something more coherent and a better system of institutions without a catastrophe, you know, last time it took two world wars for us to do it, I'd like to think that this time we can think about shoring up our institutions without waiting for a similar calamity. I'm not all that confident that we will, however. And then I think the final question from my 18 to 22-year-old Georgetown student, it's befitting a very smart 18 to 22-year-old. There's also a piece in the book about what I call sort of trickle-down war, the ways in which the changes in institutions and rules internationally are kind of filtering down domestically. And I do think it's a really big issue, and it cuts across multiple domains, that the very same lack of accountability, for instance, and secrecy that we become willing to tolerate when it comes to national security activities, we're seeing that kind of trickle down into criminal law and increased willingness when it comes to ordinary crime to tolerate ex parte and in-camera proceedings where only one side is there, in which evidence can be suppressed because it touches on classified matters. We're seeing less transparency in government overall. We're seeing some trickle down into the policing realm. And I think it's really hard to trace, and the causation is really hard to be confident about it. But I do worry that just as the law of armed conflict internationally allows much greater government secrecy and much greater scope for the use of coercion and lethal force when there's a war, that similarly, U.S. domestic law has historically, courts are much more deferential to government use of force, surveillance, intrusions on rights when there are claims that are made that have to do with national security. And I think that trickles down into other areas from contract law to tort law as well. But I won't go into any more detail about that other than to say the chapter in the book on this is just so great. You're just really going to want to buy the book. And I think we're done. So thank you all very much.